I shall now read for us God's precious word from Mark 8, 27 to 38 in the ESV version. You may want to follow along the slides that we projected or even in your own Bibles. And Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they told him, "John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and others one of the prophets." And he asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Christ." And he strictly charged them to tell no one about him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of men." And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's sake will save it. But for what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The Lord's messenger today is our brother Deacon Paul.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters in Christ, friends. My name is Deacon Paul. If you don't know me, I'm from the Chinese services, now currently serving at the Hokkien service. If you look at our church name, in English it's easy to pronounce, it's Zion Bishan Bible Presbyterian Church. Try doing that in Mandarin, our full name is Tu Sing Sheng Jing Zhang Lao Hui Bishan Xie En Tang. Hokkien, Tao Xin Sheng Jing Tiu Lo Hui Bik Sam Ha Un Teng. So, I'm from this service, and I do welcome you to visit one of our Chinese services, if you can, as well, in our church. So glad that we now have growing, and we have more family members among us. Do give us a visit. We do have Chinese brothers and sisters in Christ serving in other services as well. We know that it is now 5 days to Christmas, and we know that this Christmas is different. It's different from the rest of what you used to do during Christmas. In case you forget, we are still at what you call the MOH DOSCON level, DOSCON orange. And the fact that I'm still wearing a mask while speaking says it all. In fact, all of us are wearing a mask and doing social distancing. So let us maybe just rewind, or you want to forward also can. Rewind a bit and go back to times where before COVID-19, where there's no tracing together, no social distancing, no masks. What would Christmas be like for all of you? Maybe I can start it with this question. What's the first thing that comes to your mind about Christmas? What's the first thing that comes to your mind about Christmas? For Singaporeans, maybe it's things like, sale, shopping, gifts, or maybe feasts, turkey dinners. But is this the same? Or even holidays, public holidays. We know that this is a public holiday. December 25th is a public holiday in Singapore. But is this the same for everywhere else? I happen to have worked in Taiwan for about 2 years, many years ago, 10 years ago. So I have actually spent 2 Christmas in Taiwan. And if you ask me the question, what is the first thing that comes to your mind about Christmas in Taiwan? I would say not feast, not gifts, but holiday. Why? It's a typical day, it's a typical public holiday. Actually, in Taiwan, it is not a public holiday. So imagine my surprise on that Christmas Day itself, many years back. On Christmas Day morning, I was planning to do some Christmas trips to somewhere in Taiwan while wondering, how come churches in Taiwan don't have morning services? They are all in the evening. So I was planning that when I received a phone call from my office. "你为什么没有来上班? Why you didn't come to work that day? It's not a public holiday. I didn't know that. So for 30 odd years of my life, no Christmas, no need automatic public holiday. So I realized that, that's my assumption. In Taiwan, it's not a public holiday, it is a working day. So which means that they, having a working day as a Christmas for Christmas, will have to celebrate Christmas quite differently from what we do here in Singapore. Probably, Christmas Eve, they can't do late nights because the next day they have to work, and then they have to shift. We're going to have morning services this coming Friday. They can't do that anymore. They have to do everything in the evening. Then what this tells me, and I hope what this tells you, is that Christmas in different places, in different environments, may mean different things to people. Just like the question I asked, what's the first thing that comes to your mind about Christmas? Some of you may be thinking about other things, except and not know what the true meaning of Christmas is really about. But for us Christians, we know that Christmas is about Jesus. It's about the birth of Jesus. And as a Christian who have attended Christmas services for more than 30 years, I would then say that we are all very familiar with the Christmas story. So for friends here today among us, maybe you have for Christmas for you have been about holidays, have been about gifts and dinners and sales. But I hope that today we can present to you a Christmas that is maybe a bit different from what you hear. And I will call this like the oldest perspective on Christmas, and also the true meaning of Christmas. And we're going to do this not by telling you about the birth of Jesus all over again. We're going to be doing this from the passage that we have just read, Mark chapter 8, verses 27 to 38. And in this passage that we have, our dear brother Michael has just read, we have Jesus actually asking us 2 questions. Actually, it's the same question, but to two different group of people. Who do people say I am? And who do you say that I am? And this comes from verses 27 and 29 of Mark chapter 8, if you wish to read it up again. Back in Jesus' time, and even today, who do people think Jesus is? Maybe for people back then, it's not even a question at all. Because they were seeing Jesus, Jesus to them is a real person. They were with Jesus, they have seen Jesus, they have heard Jesus, they have lived with Jesus, in fact. So for us today, when we ask, who do you think Jesus is? Maybe, is this like a character from a story that we always hear? A character from a Bible, a huge storybook called the Bible? Or is he just a religious leader? that teach us to be morally good, and one of those, you know, many religious leaders around the world. Is it just that? Well, 5 years ago in America, someone did a research on who do you think, they asked this question, who do you think Jesus is? And the most common answer, the one that got the highest percentage, 92%, said that Jesus is a real person. Now, to us, maybe, okay, this is really very take for granted. Jesus is a real person. Perhaps maybe we can think about this. Jesus came to this world, he was a real person, and that he's not just any, you know, a character, fictional character that was, you know, drawn up by some authors to please people, to sell books, that kind of thing. So he was a real person to people back then. He is also a real person to at least Americans. What about you, friends, who have maybe heard Jesus, who hate the name of Jesus before? And, you know, what do you think he is? Is he a real person to you? And if he is a real person to you, maybe then you can maybe think deeper into, like, maybe what this real person is saying, is doing, and what can you do to our lives? So when Jesus asked the question a second time, this time he asked the disciples, who do you say that I am? He's asking some of his closest acquaintance, his closest disciples, one of them Peter, and asking them this question, who do you say that I am? And then his disciple, Peter, answered him, you are the Christ. You are the Christ. Or in some versions, you are the Messiah, which can mean Savior, which can mean Lord, or you may also define it, the Chosen One. The Chosen One. When you Google the Chosen One today, you will get maybe a variety of results. You may get things like movies about Chosen Ones. You may get, you know, results of political figures who claim to be a Chosen One, some special one that solve all economical problems, solve all political problems, even climate change, that kind of thing. Or if you are a movie fan like myself, who have followed Star Wars for many years, you know that in the Star Wars franchise, every trilogy is about some special ones, even though, unfortunately, some of these special ones may turn bad and then, you know, create disastrous consequences. And then, in sports also, we have people calling themselves special ones. And then, these special ones would, you know, be, you know, employed by football clubs to be managers or coaches and trying to win World Cups, FA Cups, Premier Leagues, Champions League, that sort of thing. But they often get sacked. So when we heard about this word Chosen One, we think of all these common things: fame, riches, success, admiration are all part of the package of being a Chosen One. So when Peter said, you are the Christ, you are the Chosen One, you are the Anointed One, you are the Special One, is it the same thing? And what did Jesus say? And Jesus began to teach them in Mark verses 31, then this is what he said, and he began to teach them the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. This is what Jesus said. He, the Messiah, the Special One, saying that he will be killed, he will be rejected, he will be killed and rejected by people. So instead of enjoying riches and lives, he suffered. Instead of being accepted by leaders, they rejected him. Instead of being crowned as the Chosen One, he was killed. If the story ended here, then there's nothing special. We could dismiss Jesus as someone who was probably a little crazy and ended up paying with his life for his actions. But at the end of his sentence, he said he will rise again. And he did. The Bible tells us that he rose from the dead 3 days later, overcoming death. That's why in the Christian calendar, we also celebrate Good Friday, the day that he was crucified, and Easter Sunday, the day he rose back from the dead. So what's going on here? Why did he have to die? The answer lies directly in verses 35 when Jesus said that all our souls, all our lives ought to be saved and not to be destroyed. In other Bible passages, Jesus tells us that he came to this world to die for our sins, so that through him, our souls can be saved, bringing us to be close to God forever. My dear friends, we are all sinners, and the Bible tells us that sin must be punished. The punishment for sin is death. The only one who takes our punishment is someone who is perfect. One sinner cannot die for another, just like no more than one criminal can take another criminal's punishment. But Jesus Christ, being the perfect Son of God, took the sinner's place and died as our substitute, so that while we are sinners, we would face the wrath of God, but Jesus, by dying on the cross for us, took our sins with him. He overcame death by his resurrection, and therefore, whoever believes in him and calls him Savior has all their sins washed away. Those who respond in this way now possess a new life as a Christian. This is actually such a wonderful news, and it comes from Jesus, a real person, Son of God, the chosen one, the Savior, for you and for me. So, Jesus not only tells us who he is, the suffering Christ who came to save our lives, he is also challenging every one of us who have heard this passage, who have read this passage, to respond. In verse 34, he challenges his listeners to follow him. So he said, what is more important, saving your soul forever or gaining the world for a limited time? Follow me, he said. But why should I? Well, friends, you don't have to look very far for an answer. Why should I? Just probably, I can be a perfect example of why we should follow Jesus. If you look at me, I'm sure most of you don't know me. And listening to me for the first time, I hope that your impression of me is the same as what people often tell me. What people often tell me is, or rather, what do people say I am? People will normally tell me this: you look like the guai guai type. You look like the, you know, what Chinese call 老师人, you know, 乖乖的老师的, 不会, you know, you won't go around doing all sorts of things. So I hope I don't surprise you if I tell you that, you know, in my teenage years, I almost got into gang fights, stolen money from my parents, quarrel with them, and, you know, have did some really nasty things to my friends as well. So me, the guai guai type, you know, on the outside looks like guai guai type, but actually, you know, is a sinner just like any one of those people that you would think as deem as sinners. We don't have to also look very far. We just have to read the news every day, and then you will see news reports of you know, fights breaking out, murders that happen, accidental murders sometimes. And then every time you probably hear, like, maybe the reporters asking neighbors of like what happened, the neighbors will tell, hey, I'm very surprised that they seem like a very good family, and this kind of thing could happen to them. This tells us that, no, we are all sinners, and we really need Christ to be in our lives. So I've heard the good news of Christ, Jesus Christ, and my life was transformed. So this Christmas season, all of us who have accepted him as our Savior, hope you heard the same message that we heard and respond in the way that we did. He's coming to save your soul, and he's coming here to really save your soul. So respond to him by deciding to follow Jesus. So maybe we can ask you this question: who is Jesus according to you? If all I've said about Jesus is true, what would you now do? Let me just share a testimony from someone who is like a brother, from a testimony that I've heard from a brother, what we call maybe a testimony that we as Christians have often heard about being life being transformed. This is about a young man who grew up in the streets, and the street raised him and made him a gangster. He is so dope, he had been in shootouts, fights, in and out of jail since age of 17, robbed people, got robbed, drunk, used to club, used to take drugs, and when he was in jail, facing 5 to 10 years, he had an encounter with Jesus. And Jesus made him all over again at the age of 23. So he can claim that he's now free and born again. Jesus, a mighty Savior, bless his holy name. This is his own testimony that was typed out in one of his comments. So a person who had been a gangster, his life was transformed. And then his life was transformed because he accepted Jesus as his Savior. You, I'm sure most of us will never try to be a gangster in our lives. We don't have to do that. But we can also accept Jesus Christ as our Savior. So 5 more days, we're coming to Christmas. I hope that Christmas is just more than a public holiday for you. Like it is a matter of life and death. It is where you have heard the good news Jesus brings, and where you can ask yourself this question: who is Jesus? And we hope that your answer is like Peter. Sorry. You are the Christ. Perhaps then you can, if you are really thinking more about this, and if you would like to find out more, we really encourage you to approach any one of us after the service, and we are willing to share more to you. We really hope that this is your response. Who is Jesus to you? We hope that you say, you are the Christ. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come to you thanking you for telling us what we have just heard and reminding us of who Jesus is. As Apostle Peter said many years ago, you are the Christ, true Savior of the world. Some of us here today have experienced your sweet salvation and are now following you. How joyous and blessed this journey is. May you continue to lead us, hold our fragile hands, and journey on. We also pray for our friends here who may be hearing this for the first time. And God, we ask you that you move their hearts to believe that this is true, that we must take up the cross, follow you. There's nothing we can give in exchange for our soul, that the world is telling us to be self-centered and is leading us towards sin. By following you, we are now coming close to you. We can know, instead of following the world, we are not destroying ourselves and we are not destroying others. Your words are so powerful, challenging us to be sacrificial, just like you've shown us how to, just like what you have actually did for all of us. We pray that through this message, that our friends will come to know you. We all pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.